The season premiere, what was most interesting to me is it's really leaning into the weirdness. And it's to the point where it reminds me of the 1970s Archie Adventure comics.
Right, right.
Now, seeing how Riverdale kind of exists in a heightened reality already, what are the challenges you face to make sure that, you know, you can really get weird and strange with it, but not alienate viewers?
Yeah, you know, it's that's kind of the big, one of the big challenges of the show is, you know, now we're entering our third season. We did a murder mystery season one. We did a serial killer season two. We did a Godfather-like story in season two. So, you know, it's hard to come up with... You don't want to repeat yourself. But the show kind of needs a strong genre, crime or pulp or noir elements. It's always figuring out what is that element and how is it different from earlier iterations. As for how do we know when we've gone too far, it's just too weird and gonzo. You know, we just trust our guts a little bit on that, you know. We're always pushing forward though, and when there's the safe choice or the risky choice, we almost always go for the risky choice. And I think people really respond to that, you know. It's kind of, and also like kind of once you start down that path, it's hard to go back and just tell stories about, you know, Archie wanting to write a song.
Yeah.
Who's going to be the breakout character in season three?
That is a really good question. Who's going to be the breakout character in season three? I think the Gargoyle King is going to be something that I hope people talk about. But in terms of characters, they're all doing really good stuff. I think people are really excited for Jughead's family to come to town, and I think they've got really good stuff. Who was the breakout character last year, do you think? Tony?
Maybe.
Yeah, Tony. In terms of new characters, yeah.
Yeah. I would say Tony.
Yeah. Yeah. I think Tony and Cheryl, I think people are really excited to see more of those two. Uh-huh. We will. Everyone's got good stuff, I think.
When you approach a season of art with Riverdale, you know, do you look at fan comments online and let it influence you in any way?
You know, not really. I don't do tons on social media myself. I like sometimes read recaps and stuff, but not really. Usually we before we start the season, we spend, you know, a good month just talking, and I have ideas, other writers have ideas. I'll always meet with the actors, hear what they want to do, but not really. Not, I think that you know, sometimes you hear things and it lines up with what you're thinking. Sometimes you hear things and it doesn't line up with what you're thinking. I think it's we just kind of do our thing.
Living in a Me Too world, are we going to talk any more about the Hiram and Hermione relationship? Which there's always these hints, but it's never been fully fleshed out, the kind of abusive relationship that they have.
Yeah. That's a really good question. We're definitely gonna explore more about the Hiram Hermione relationship. The question of, is Hermione Hiram's puppet, and is she trapped in a marriage to a potentially violent guy? We're definitely gonna explore that. You know, or is it something that we don't even know yet? You know what I mean? Or don't quite understand? It could be that too.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you talk about the storyline that you are going to explore this season? Because we have like a big secret with Ben's family, with Bolly, the dynamic.
Yeah. So, one thing that we're doing is we're launching two or three pretty big, usually big storylines in the first 8 or 10 episodes. One is the farm that Polly and Jason were going to go to comes to Riverdale. So we explore what that farm is like, and that's a mysterious cult-like organization. And then there's a pretty gruesome ritualistic death of two Riverdale High students that is a mystery we're going to be exploring as well.
When you spoke before about always taking the risky, dangerous route, do you feel that there's ever a time when you need to leave something so you have room to grow later? Because like 24 had the new second season.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. We talk about that in the writer's room all the time. You know, our philosophy is pull it forward, do it, and find out what's on the other side. You know, we and you know, some of the stories we're doing in season three are stories that we talked about for season one but didn't have the room to do. So, but our philosophy is like bring it forward, play it, make it story, and then find out what's on the other side of it, as opposed to, you know, tread water and then at episode 13 do this. Usually we're just like, and you know, we plot out the board, right? We do like a cork board with episode 1, 2, you know, through 22, and we find that we're already pulling up stuff from the second half of the season up into the first.
You said the actors are allowed to give you some input. Can you cite anything in particular that they've contributed?
Yes,
worked
its
way in?
I can give you one very specific example. Madeline told me that she wanted to do archery. So the reason Cheryl got into archery is because she said she would like to do it. And she thought I'd forgotten about that, but then around, then we when the Black Hood went after her, she got her old crossbow out, her bow out. So that came directly from her.
Wow.
Yeah.
Can you tell us anything about a potential new musical episode this season?
You know, I love musicals. My background is the theater, and everyone loved that musical. I did too. We want to do one, but I'm not going to lie. You know, that was the perfect musical at the perfect point in the season. It like docked with the stories. To me, we have to be able to like. It has to be the right show at the right time with the right characters, or else it'll just be a less than version. Right. In which case, we wouldn't do it. So, but I'm hopeful. I love musicals.
Are we looking at like a full-fledged gang war that's ramping up? Because the tension seems.
Yeah, you know, it's. I was saying earlier, you know, when you pitch a show, I never thought that Riverdale was going to be a crime show or a gang show or you know, a drug show or anything like that. It is all those things now. We are definitely going to see more stuff with the different gangs in Riverdale, absolutely.
And we're also going to see the younger versions of the parents?
We do, in a flashback episode in episode 4.
Oh.
Yeah, so very, really early on, it turned out really, really well. I think fans will be really excited for it. But we see the grown-ups when they were in high school, and what's interesting is we see them as they were, mm-hmm. how and why they became friends, and then how and why they became the grown-ups we know today. So it's not like we see Alice as like the preppy, you know, button-down sweater wearing. We see Alice as a serpent. You know, we don't see FP as a serpent. We see FP as the big man on campus, who was hiding his serpent past. So we see, you know, it's a really, I'm really excited for that episode. I think it's special.
How often the actors in the show deviate from the script and improvise?
No, they pretty much follow the scripts.
Verbatim?
No one follows anything verbatim. I mean, that's not true. Some actors memorize them exactly. Some paraphrase a little bit more than others. It depends on the actor and the day. You know, if there's a lot of things to memorize, you know, it's a little looser. And we have someone on set that's saying, oh, no, the line is this and stuff like that.
With such a terrific ensemble, how do you make sure you work each one in? And is there someone that you're hoping to weave more into the storyline in this next season?
Yeah, it's always the supporting actors. I think, you know, all of the cast on this show could be leads and mm-hmm. could have their own show. So we have a huge cast, and mm-hmm. it's finding time and real estate to tell deep stories for all of them. I think we're getting a little bit better, but that's the challenge, one of the core challenges of this show, I think.
It's a good challenge to have.
It's a good challenge to have, yeah.
Are we going to get to go to Greendale at all?
It's a very good question. Let me think. Through episode 10, not yet.
Okay. Not yet. So there's potential.
Always.
What's your process like in the writer's room to crafting an episode?
It's a conversation. You know, we start talking about what an episode could be about thematically, and we think about what is this character going through? What are our characters going through? We talk about each character, and then we sort of talk about the plot or what the events that could illuminate it. But we try to talk about what the character is going through emotionally first, and then hang the plot on it. But it's really collaborative, really collaborative.
What's the experience been like for you personally, going from like the cease and desist for Archie's Weird Fantasy to like being basically the king of Archie television?
Yeah, surreal. No, John Goldwater, who's the publisher and owner of Archie, really believed in me, and really believed in and being fearless in terms of taking risks and changing stuff. But yeah, it's funny. I'm here in New York. I now mostly live in LA, but I have a place here in New York, and I have all my old play posters up here in New York, and one of them is for Archie's Weird Fantasy, and I'm like, I've been writing this crazy stuff for 20 years.
Yeah.
So it's a little mind-blowing.
Yeah.
It's a nice story. It's a nice story to go from being sued to not being sued.
Yeah.
Are there any like unusual or weird pairings that we might not expect for this upcoming season?
I think one of the weirder pairings is Veronica and Jughead. Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, they don't really haven't really done much, but they we have a couple of strange team ups between the two of them.
Well, is Veronica now the only character who's not a serpent of the four? And does that change?
Yeah, membership in the Serpents is going to go through. There are going to be some changes to the Serpent membership over the first 10 episodes.
How, you elaborate?
How difficult was it to find the right people to play Jughead's family?
Very difficult. I mean, that's why we kept putting it off. You know, we were going to introduce them in the first episode, and then we couldn't find them. So it's like, okay, well, we'll save them for kind of the more middle section. When you've got, you know, Mark Consuelos and Machen Amick and Luke Perry and Skeet Ulrich, and, you know, you kind of, it has to be somebody, right? Mm-hmm. Like who can hold their own against all of them and hopefully tell part of the strange Riverdale story. And, you know, enter Gina Gershon, who is that, you know, and you know, I love that she was in one of my favorite noir movies, Bound, and she was in Killer Joe, which is another kind of neo-noir, you know, for showgirls and stuff. But really for her crime movies, she feels like she's telling that story, which is really nice.
How do you feel about the whole idea, because before she asked you to elaborate, about the idea of spoilers and how today, you know, they're streaming shows, and they released them all at once. Is that kind of idea of spoilers evolving as shows change?
You know, I can only speak for myself, and you know, either you hate spoilers or you don't mind spoilers. And I don't mind spoilers. You know, like when people go see movies, you know, and I'm like, oh well, you know, like oh well, what happens? You know, and they're like, do you want it? And I'm like, no, I don't mind knowing. You know. I know fans get mad when stuff is spoiled for them, and I understand that as well. It's hard to keep some things secret or under wraps just because everyone's always posting something. Everyone's always taking a picture of something. You know, and we'll have, you know, guest star actors come on and suddenly be tweeting up crazy pictures and stuff like that. So I try not to get... It's kind of hard to control. So I like to not get stressed out about things I can't control. So there's plenty to get stressed out about. Like, it's like, yeah, but it's hard to control.